Well, I'll say this. It's definitely not the Little Mermaid. What's up, everybody? It's me, Dan the Film Gent, again. It's a brand new year. It's a brand new full of movies that's come to our way, and I'm very excited. I cannot wait. I mean, I haven't been to the movie theaters all that much, maybe because of Marvel and stuff like that. I haven't had the chance to check out, you know, some of the latest non-Marvel projects that are out there. But this time, I wanna try to do something, you know, less Marvelous. Pun intended, by the way. You know, like I saw Nope last year, which was pretty good. Not great as Get Out or Us, but pretty good overall. But anyway, this is not about last year. This is about the highly anticipated movies that's coming out this year. And not right now. Like, mostly in the summer or in the fall. Or November. Or Thanksgiving, Christmas, whatever you name it. One of the movies I'm mostly interested in... not really, but it's the Marvels. I feel like this is a chance for Carol Danvers to, you know, redeem herself a little bit. She's still not very an interesting character. Because her first movie wasn't all that pleasant. It was fine, but it was just very mediocre. I found Carol's personality to be a little bit boring at times. But hopefully, you know, something works out here with the right director. And I heard it's the same director who developed that Candyman show, or that Candyman movie that came out a couple of years ago. So, but then again, you don't want to get your hopes high too well. Because I remember Chloe Zhao directed No Man's Land, which was a fantastic movie, as I've heard. I have yet to see it. And people were proud of that. And look what happened to Eternals. So I don't want to get your hopes too high. Hopefully, you know, Nia DiCastio, I think that's how you say her name, develops her character very good. And, you know, we're getting other characters such as the Monica from WandaVision to come in, who has ties with Captain Marvel. And you have Kamala Khan, who, you know, is supposed to be a rookie in all this and supposed to get, you know, some type of experience. And, you know, is such a huge fangirl of Carol. So I want to see how that dynamic goes. Number two, most anticipated movie, it's coming back to Marvel, baby. And that is Ant-Man and the Wasp, Quantumania. This one's pretty interesting. I have yet to see the trailers. I mean, granted, I don't watch the trailers. I don't like watching trailers. But I heard it's supposed to be somewhat exciting for a lot of people, mainly because of Kang the Conqueror. Major film debut is here this year, and people are a little frightened by this guy. Supposed to be worse than Thanos and worse than any villain that they've ever come across. But other than that, you know, it's interesting to see, you know, what Scott's been doing after, you know, his time in Endgame after helping the Avengers. Hopefully it's a different story than this, you know, this criminal needs to do something to redeem himself to, you know, get appeased by his family, which was just why I kind of didn't really enjoy the second film. I did, but I wasn't really too keen on it, just seeing that same plot again. But it looks different. It does look different, and I'm glad that, you know, they're finally giving that Ant-Man the chance to, you know, redeem himself and try to, you know, improve himself even after Endgame. But we'll see. And I heard Scott, you know, has a podcast, but so that'd be interesting if we get somewhat of an insight, you know, of him telling his stories with the Avengers of how he, you know, used time travel to save the Earth, to save everyone who got snapped. I mean, I feel like they're going to do something that makes Scott very feel underappreciated by the rest of the world. Kind of like how he felt underappreciated in Endgame when everyone kept shitting on him left and right, which is unfair for the poor guy. And I'm just pretty curious about what they're going to do with his daughter as well. I know they changed the actress from the Avengers movie, which is odd, I admit. Well, let's hope, what's her name? Casey, that's right. Let's see how Casey, you know, does better in her father's shoe. I mean, there's some rumors that it may not be a happy ending in the movie, but we'll see. Let's see what happens in here. And I'm pretty excited. I'm not really that excited, but I want to, like, go in with low expectations just to see how this plays out. If, you know, if Kang is, you know, supposed to be this dangerous bad boy that Kevin Feige's promising he is, who knows? We'll see. Okay, let's get out of Marvel for a little bit. Another movie that I'm pretty anticipated for is... Shit, let me see. Another movie I'm pretty anticipated for.
Oh, brother, this guy stinks!
Okay, so another movie I'm pretty anticipated for, even though I don't know why they're, you know, suddenly doing this again after the fourth one didn't really do that well, and that is Indiana Jones 5. Something about trial. I forgot the title. I'm pretty excited to see what Harrison Ford does. I mean, granted, I know everyone loves Indiana Jones. You know, this is set to be his last role as Indy, which is understandable because the dude's like, what, 100 years old at this point? Like, you're going to kill him if he keeps doing these stunts like this and that. But you know what? We're not his parents, whatever. But it is pretty... I just hope he goes out on a high note. I mean, granted, it does suck that Spielberg didn't come back to finish this one off since he's the one who kind of started this Mamba Jam in the first place. But I will say, I will also come back because I heard this is supposed to be, and I know it's a rumor, but I heard this is supposed to be John Williams' swan song, and then he retires from film composing. But not composing in general, but I mean, if he does do it, then, you know, it's a hell of a way to end a great, like 70, 80 career, something like that, or 50 year career in Hollywood, which is well deserved because we have to appreciate everything that John has done for the world, how much music, how much melody he's produced for all of us, for all his audiences, how much famous songs have been produced because of him, and the amount of times that we hum the same themes over and over again. We have to appreciate the good things from him because the man's not going to be here any longer. We don't know when, but we feel like his time might be coming up, and I know we're not going to be prepared for it. Okay, another film that I'm pretty anticipated for.
Thanks!
Another movie that I'm pretty anticipated for is the final swan song for the Guardians of the Galaxy. That's right, the third one comes out this year. I'm pretty excited. I haven't seen the trailers for it, but I am pretty interesting how they're going to close this out. I feel like this is the year where it's the final arcs for some of these characters. I feel like, you know, Guardians is going to go out on a high note. I mean, this is like, it's supposed to be very emotional, very more emotional than what we got in Volume 2. Which is pretty nice. I enjoyed the Christmas special that just came out on Disney Plus. But I am curious how this is going to come into play, how this is going to close out everything. And, you know, Drax's actor, Batista, said that he wasn't all comfortable wearing all that makeup during filming all those movies, which is understandable. I mean, I can't say for sure, but it does look very interesting. It does look like it's going to take a more serious note. It's going to drop the lightheartedness and it's going to drop the humor. I mean, it's going to keep the humor. This movie's supposed to be about Rocket and where he came from, where he orchestrated, how he learned how to steal, how he learned how to talk, how he learned how to snark, how he learned how to repair ships and whatnot. How do you learn to be, you know, the Rocket that we all know and love? You know, it'll be pretty interesting how they close out Drax and Gamora's storyline, which is pretty interesting. I don't know what they're going to do with Gamora. That's not the same Gamora that got killed in Infinity War. This is, the past Gamora. So I want to see how, you know, that plays out. How, like, what their dynamic with Quill and her, how they developed that. I mean, granted, I know there's some people who feel, like, a little cheapened by that. The fact that we have to do all that all over again, you know, trying to see Quill win Gamora's heart once again, which is understandable. I feel like it's somewhat of a cop-out again. But, you know, I'm just glad that they're trying to get the gang back together in some capacity, even if it's a time travel, you know, mix-up. Let's just see what they do with Drax's character, because I'll be honest, Drax is becoming less and less and less interesting as the time goes by. I mean, he was pretty interesting in the first Guardians, and then, you know, as the sequels went by, he just became like such a butt monkey. He became such a, you know, a guy with weird sense of humor who doesn't really add anything other than just cracking, you know, weird ass jokes from here and there. I mean, great character and all, but I just feel like, you know, his story is kind of up. I mean, now with Thanos gone, like, what are they going to do with Drax now? So for my final anticipation, I know some of you guys in the comments are like, what? Really? This is your most anticipated film? These movies suck. Michael Bay did this, that, and that. And you're right, but it's a rebooted version. My most anticipated movie for this year has to be Transformers: The Rise of the Beast. Oh yeah. I mean, hey, I mean, the Michael Bay movies, I mean, say what you will about the Michael Bay movies, I get it. You know, they're horrendous. They have such cheap jokes, horrible writing, inconsistent plot lines, inconsistent story, not much care about the lore. I mean, the lore is like all over the place. I totally get why people hate it so much. But, you know, it was my introduction to, you know, some of these amazing characters. Except for the human characters. That's something I will agree on. The human characters are just so useless at this point. Except for, well, maybe Bumblebee, but still, they were just like very exception. But, you know, Rise of the Beast is supposed to be another great introduction into this rebooted version after, you know, Bumblebee, which was such an amazing movie. I enjoyed that. Like, if we get more, you know, character-driven stories, like character studies, like from Bumblebee or some of these human characters, or hell, I mean, like, if we get a more character study for Optimus Prime, then, yeah, I think these movies will go in the right direction, away from the Michael Bay style. I mean, I hope there's more consistent lore. I hope there's more... I don't know, this is confusing. I mean, my thing is, the reason I say inconsistent, I mean, is this supposed to be a sequel to Bumblebee, or is this like another like alternate, you know, universe where nothing's really connected to one another, which is kind of bizarre. It's a little weird, but let's just see how this plays out. I mean, if they do mention some things from Bumblebee, it's just great to see, you know, I've never seen the Beast Wars, the TV show. I mean, I checked some clips in here and there. I'm like, yikes, the animation does look weird. I mean, I get it. It's the 90s, but still, it does look weird. But I'm pretty interested how they're going to, you know, pen this out in live action. I mean, it does look a little wonky. It does look a little cheesy, some of the CGI. But, you know, let's just hope it proves me wrong. Let's hope it's another smash in the box office with these movies. And it's always great to see... It's always great to hear Peter Cullen back as the voice of Optimus Prime. And I did hear... And yes, I did hear that, you know, he wasn't officially the voice in Bumblebee because they had to hire some whippersnapper to come in and record his lines. And then they hired Peter Cullen to come in, and then he had to, you know, redub his lines. So that's kind of a bummer right there. Again, it's always great to hear Peter Cullen, even though they did him somewhat of a disservice in that movie. But hey, still a great movie overall. I mean, there are some movies that I'm not really anticipating because I'm just like, I don't really care about the series or whatever. Like Fast and Furious, I just gave up. I'm probably not going to watch that again. And there's also other movies like John Wick that I haven't seen the movies, so I don't really have an opinion there. Oh, yeah. I forgot to say Mario. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. Mario, I'm kind of in the mixed bag. I keep forgetting that movie's still a thing. And I know people are like cracking jokes about how Chris Pratt portrays Mario or whatever. Okay. Cool, I guess. Maybe I'll see it, maybe not, I don't know. I mean, I've always been on the brink. I've always been mixed with Illumination with how they make their movies. If there's something I missed, you can say it down in the comments. I will get back to you. Let's see how this goes out. And, you know, I'm just excited for this year. Let's just see how this goes out. There's some movies I'm probably going to go see right now. All right. If you enjoyed this video, hit the like button, comment down below, subscribe if you want to. And I'll catch you guys in the next video. Goodbye and take care.